Hi, this is Corey Franklin with Remembering the Past, the show where we talk about people who've died recently who've had a profound effect on our history, our society, or our culture. Tonight we're going to start out with Henry Ruth. Henry Ruth was an attorney who died recently at the age of 80, and he was a critical figure in the Watergate scandal. Ruth was part of the special prosecutor's office that was involved in the Saturday Night Massacre. For those of you unfamiliar with Watergate and the Saturday Night Massacre, brief history. In June of 1972, five operatives from Richard Nixon's presidential reelection campaign were caught breaking into the Watergate Hotel trying to bug Democratic headquarters. There was an immediate cover-up that extended all the way up to Nixon's top aides and even to Nixon. There was a question of how far Nixon was involved in covering up the burglary and obstructing justice. His chief counsel, John Dean, claimed that he was involved. Nixon claimed he wasn't involved. During the proceedings and the hearings that the Congress held, they found out that there were actually tapes in the White House of Nixon discussing the Watergate break-in with some of the other people involved. Investigators subpoenaed those tapes. Nixon and the White House claimed executive privilege. And the Saturday Night Massacre was when Nixon fired the special prosecutor. And then the attorneys general and their deputies resigned in protest over the firing. Here's a brief description of the events that ultimately led to the resignation of Richard Nixon from the presidency.
The Saturday Night Massacre was the firing of Archibald Cox. Cox wanted the tapes from Nixon, but Nixon wouldn't give them up, and he told Attorney General Elliot Richardson to fire Cox, but he refused and quit. Then he told Deputy Attorney General William Ruckelshaus to fire Cox, but he refused and quit. He finally got Solicitor General Robert Bork to do it. The American public was outraged, and they viewed this as a desperate attempt by Nixon to stop the pursuit of justice. Nixon's popularity fell to 17%. It was obvious that Nixon had lost his credibility and no longer was effective in his role as president. Nixon made a last-ditch effort to hold on to the tapes by offering to give a transcript of the tapes to the House Judiciary Committee. They refused. They wanted the actual tapes. On July 24, 1974, the Supreme Court ruled that Nixon had to give the subpoenaed tapes to the special prosecutor. The House Judiciary Committee, on the same day, began its procedures to begin the impeachment of Richard Nixon.
Well, Henry Ruth was right there for the Saturday Night Massacre. No one is better prepared to describe it than him. And several years later to Congress, he gave a firsthand account of what happened during the Saturday Night Massacre.
I swear the testimony you're about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth to help you God. I do. Our panel is made up first of Henry Ruth. Mr. Ruth was Deputy Watergate Special Prosecutor. He's currently counsel to Unisys. I hope I pronounced that correctly. And second, Mr. George Frampton. Mr. Frampton is a former assistant Watergate special prosecutor and is currently president of the Wilderness Society. Gentlemen, welcome. Please proceed with your statements, and your entire statements will be placed in the record as if read, and we would appreciate summarization as best as you can.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. I have no prepared statement. I thought I'd take a few minutes to describe what happened in Saturday Night Massacre. I was a senior man on the Watergate Special Prosecution Force that evening. The background to that was that the Watergate Special Prosecution Force had been created by a charter between the Attorney General and the Special Prosecutor. The charter had the force and effect of law. It was published in the Code of Federal Regulations. Certain irony was posted in that section of the regulations following the office of the pardon attorney. It has the force of effective law, and in U.S. v. Nixon, the Supreme Court so held. We started our work, and it soon became clear when the existence of presidential tapes became known that the tapes were the key to tell whether or not John Dean was a liar or President Nixon was lying. On October 19, 1973, John Dean, the president's counsel, pleaded guilty to obstruction of justice. The obstruction of justice included conversations with the president of the United States. Those conversations were on the nine tapes that were the subject of the subpoena that had been upheld by the U.S. District Court and the U.S. Court of Appeals for the District of Columbia Circuit. The White House had until Friday, October 19, to tell the court whether it was going to appeal. Friday came and went. Meanwhile, we had been in disputes with Mr. Richardson and the White House for 3 months on our jurisdiction. Every time we touched upon national security, we would get a call that we were exceeding our jurisdiction. And that was, in my opinion, because we did not yet know about COINTELPRO and the FBI. We did not know the full activity of the plumbers, a group of White House employees going beyond the bounds of law to invade the psychiatrist of Daniel Ellsberg. We did not know the full extent of the activities of the 10 White House employees who subsequently became felons as a result of our work. Friday, October 19, we were told by the White House that we should subpoena no more tapes and that we were to accept transcripts from John Stennis, who unfortunately had been shot the previous January and was a 72-year-old ailing man. Archie Cox, of course, refused, and we were confronted with the fact that the tapes, which were the only source of evidence to prove whether John Dean was telling the truth, was not to be ours, and so Archie Cox could not accept that. He told the nation that Saturday morning, October 20, and we waited. We wondered who was going to fire Archie Cox, because the regulation had the force and effect of law. We knew that the tapes contained evidence of a criminal conspiracy between John Dean and the President of the United States, and we didn't think anyone in the Justice Department would undertake to fire a prosecutor for securing evidence of a crime. So we speculated as to who might do it, and we did not think Elliot Richardson would do it, but we had no idea who would. About 8 o'clock that evening, Mr. Cox called me and said the White House had sent a messenger. He called me 15 minutes later to say the messenger was lost. And he called me 15 minutes later to say he'd been fired, and we went into our office. From no one could we find out our status. I tried to reach Mr. Richardson. He was unavailable. Mr. Ruckelshaus was unavailable. Phil Lacovara, the counsel of the special prosecutor, located Mr. Bork, who said we were now part of the criminal division in the Department of Justice. I reached an old friend of mine, Henry Peterson, who still is a friend of mine, who was then head of the criminal division. I said we had Mr. Haldeman coming to the grand jury Tuesday, and we intended to do that unless I was instructed otherwise. He said, go ahead. I said we wanted to consolidate files, but the FBI had met us at the door and wouldn't let us move anything, wouldn't let us bring anything in or take anything out. Mr. Peterson said he couldn't do anything about that. We asked who was in charge, and he said Mr. Bork. For 6 or 7 days after that, the whole staff met about 4 times a day. We were totally tenuous in operation. We had no idea what was going to happen. We did not know if the president was going to produce the tapes in court on Tuesday, October 23rd. We did not know if we had authority to pursue more tapes, which, after all, was at the heart of our investigations, because taped conversations are the best evidence of all. They prevent a confrontation of one witness against another because the tapes tell exactly what happened. It was only after a week and a half where we thought that we were going to be back in business. On Tuesday, there were 10 impeachment bills introduced. There were 15 bills introduced to create special prosecutors by law. The White House was then totally on the defensive. We were afraid during that week that we were being used to perpetuate the Office of Special Prosecutor just to forestall the impeachment bills and the special prosecutor bills in the Congress. We knew that Mr. Bork opposed special prosecutors as a concept, and I think he opposed them constitutionally. And he did that in good faith. He just didn't believe in them. We knew as well that although we had the 9 tapes as a result of the president's action on Tuesday the 23rd, President Nixon had issued an order that we should not subpoena further tapes. We were told by Mr. Bork and Mr. Peterson we could ask for tapes, and indeed we renewed old requests that had been pending when Archie was fired. But we did not know, when it came time to go to court, what the Justice Department believed, i.e. Acting Attorney General Bork, about executive privilege and about whether the court should order the production of the tapes. I think because of a result of the firestorm, the impeachment bills, the special prosecutor bills, the public reaction, which to us was the most heartening, and the congressional support, which was overwhelming and for which we were all grateful, I think Nixon had to back down. And he brought in Leon Jaworski, and the rest is known.
So we say goodbye to Henry Ruth, who gave us a good account of what happened during the Saturday Night Massacre during the Watergate scandal. But we move on now to the death of Bert Sugar, and Bert Sugar was the greatest boxing writer of his generation. I just want to mention him briefly. He died recently at the age of 75. And he saw all the great fighters of the second half of the 20th century.
Joe Louis, Sugar Ray Robinson, I'm that old. I go back to Jake LaMotta. I go back to Rocky Graziano, Tony Zale. So there's another decade and another generation beyond that that I followed. Most people don't know before they turned on ESPN what the hell was happening in the world. First fight I ever saw was 1942. Little kid, granddad took me to see, and I'm a Washingtonian, Joe Louis versus Buddy Bear for a heavyweight championship.
Yeah, Bert Sugar goes back a long way. He knows a lot about boxing. We talked about him. He was quoted when we did Joe Frazier and when we did Angelo Dundee. And he was often asked, logically, who is the greatest fighter that he ever saw.
Sugar Ray Robinson, by far.
A lot of people who know boxing say the same thing. People who don't know boxing tend to think Muhammad Ali. He was very good, but here's what Bert Sugar had to say.
I've got him, and I wrote the book, the Boxing's Greatest Fighters, 100 Greatest of All Time. Ali was sixth or seventh.
That was Bert Sugar. He was controversial. He always had an opinion, but he knew an awful lot about boxing, and we're going to miss him. There isn't anybody else around like him anymore who can quote the great fighters of the second half of the 20th century. We're going to close tonight with someone who was the greatest of his profession, and it's very rare that someone who's the greatest in his profession dies, and that was Earl Scruggs, who was, without a doubt, the greatest banjoist, not only of our generation, but the greatest banjoist ever. He died recently at the age of 88, and Steve Martin, the comedian, who also plays banjo, pretty fair banjo player himself, said, "Before Earl Scruggs, no one had ever played the banjo like he did. After him, everybody played the banjo like he did, or at least tried." Earl Scruggs revolutionized not only banjo playing, took it out of the comic area, but he also revolutionized bluegrass music. He was a genius. He was a self-taught kid. The Grand Ole Opry once said he was the boy who could make the banjo sing. What Earl Scruggs did as a boy was perfect the three-finger on the right hand style of playing the banjo. Before him, most people had only used two fingers on the right hand to play. And by perfecting a style that he learned from older musicians, he could play in a staccato beat with a melody that other musicians couldn't play.
It used to be what you call two-fingered, which is actually a little misleading. It was thumb and one finger. And when I was about 10 years old, I came up with a style that had a two fingers and thumb, which is called three-finger style.
When you're a child prodigy at the banjo, you got to catch the eye or the ear of the right person, and he did. He caught the eye of Bill Monroe and his bluegrass boys, who were doing bluegrass music at the end of World War II into the early 50s, and he became a part of their group for a while. And even they realized that they were in the presence of someone special.
To me, bluegrass, when I first came here, the style of banjo that I play had never been exposed before. And I came here with Bill Monroe, and that's where the sound, I guess, probably originated. And of course, everywhere I went, I had to take it with me because that's all I know is what I play.
He lasted about 3 years with them. Bill Monroe didn't pay a lot of money, and I don't think that Earl Scruggs was an especially good businessman. Even at that young age, he was on his way to becoming a legend and joined up with another one of the people who left Bill Monroe, Lester Flatt. Lester Flatt was a good musician, was a good guitar player, but Earl Scruggs was, as I said, the genius. Lester Flatt got top billing. I've never figured that out. And they started Flatt and Scruggs and started playing all over the South, including the Grand Ole Opry. Here's a little bit of one of their first performances together, Cumberland Gap. All you have to do is listen to that banjo for a moment and know that you're listening to genius.
There's a real old-timer, Cumberland Gap, with Earl Scruggs and Lester Flatt.
No one else could play banjo like that. But the I Want to Hold Your Hand moment for Earl Scruggs, the time when he became a national name, was in 1962 when CBS started a new show that became number one in the country, and it was in part based on not only the great performances of its actors, but the opening theme song. It's called The Ballad of Jed Clampett, the opening theme song for the Beverly Hillbillies, and it featured Flatt and Scruggs, especially Earl Scruggs.
Listen to my story about a man named Jed. Poor mountaineer barely kept his family fed. And then one day he was shooting at some food, and up through the ground come a bubbling crew.
Let's see, number one on the country charts, highlighting the Newport Folk Festival and selling out Carnegie Hall. That's all Earl Scruggs did with Lester Flatt after that song. And they followed up with another CBS hit, Petticoat Junction. Not as popular, but still one of those earworm songs that you can't get out of your head and people remember almost 50 years later.
A little hotel called a Shady Rest at the Junction.
So this child prodigy out of North Carolina revolutionized the musical world with his banjo playing. He went on to play with his sons. He played with Lester Flatt for a while. And gradually he just passed on the banjo to hundreds and hundreds of banjo players across the country and across the world. He played the banjo for 75 years. A couple of months before he died, Steve Martin wrote a fitting tribute to him. And of all places, the New Yorker, hardly the place you'd think to look for a story about banjo music. Here's a little more of what Steve Martin wrote. A grand part of American music owes a debt to Earl Scruggs. Few players have changed the way we hear an instrument the way Earl has, putting him in a category with Miles Davis, Louis Armstrong, Chet Atkins, and Jimi Hendrix. His reach extends not only throughout America, but to other countries, including Japan, where bluegrass bands strangely abound, as well as Australia, Russia, the UK, Italy, Germany, and the Czech Republic, which boasts not only bands, but banjo makers. Most, if not all, of the banjo players play Scruggs style. Well, we're going to close on that note. I want to thank my producer, Sid Tepps. And our closing theme tonight will be the most famous banjo piece ever recorded. In the mid-1940s, Bill Monroe wrote a song called Bluegrass Breakdown. Earl Scruggs didn't get songwriting credit for it, and he should have. So what he did was he changed the F chord in Bluegrass Breakdown to an E minor, and the resulting song was a banjo instrumental that moved along at a clip of about 11 notes per second. He and Lester Flatt used it as their signature song for 20 years before it became a piece of Americana. Warren Beatty and Arthur Penn decided to use it in the movie Bonnie and Clyde, where it became as good a fusion of movie, music, and theme as has ever been done. Here is Earl Scruggs' greatest theme, his Beethoven's Fifth, as it were. No one has ever played the banjo better than this. This is Foggy Mountain Breakdown.